There's a replication crisis in many fields of social science, meaning that for many famous experiments that found surprising results, repeating the experiment didn't show the same thing. People have suggested that one reason for this might be that those who originally conducted the experiment could have been guilty of a practice called p-hacking. But what is a p, and how do you hack it? Imagine that I've got a coin, and I say it's a fair coin, equally likely to show heads or tails whenever you flip it. But you disagree. You suspect it might be weighted to give a certain outcome. Another way to frame this disagreement is that I argue that there is no relationship between flipping this coin in particular and the outcome of heads or tails. Statisticians call this the null hypothesis. Whereas you argue there is a relationship between tossing this coin and getting a certain outcome. Let's say heads. This is called the alternative hypothesis. So we decide to test it, flipping the coin over and over to see what happens. And right off the bat, we get four heads in a row. Now, if the coin was fair, there would be a 0.0625 likelihood of this happening. So we flip once more, getting heads again, making that five in a row. At this point, we've crossed a threshold that's been held as a standard for a long time in many fields, and that's the p equals 0.05 significance threshold. If researchers find a result that has less than a 1 in 20 chance of happening, they decide to pay attention to it, calling it significant. And this imaginary test that produced five heads in a row has a p-value of 0.03125. Another way to think of the p-value is to call it the chance of a false positive, but a specific definition of false positive that might not be the most intuitive one. It's easy to mistakenly think we might be referring to the chance that the relationship definitely isn't there compared to is there. But if you think back to the coin tossing, we wouldn't say we're 95% sure that the coin is weighted, not with just five tosses. Even though we crossed that significance threshold, with only five tosses, we'd want to see that study replicated with the same methods. What we can say is there's less than a 5% chance of it happening from tossing a fair coin, and that reflects the p-value's definition of a false positive, the chance of being in the upper left box out of anywhere in the left column. Now, this example's a bit metaphorical, and it isn't exactly how researchers run studies. Remember, we only tossed the coin five times. It's easy to calculate the probability, but we probably shouldn't be satisfied with any conclusions drawn from only five cases. So imagine if we extend the metaphor a little bit further and decide to toss the coin 100 times. Now, if I'm right and the coin is fair, you'd expect it to land on heads about half the time. But would you expect it to be exactly 50 heads? It's the most likely outcome, but the chance of it landing on heads exactly 50 times is just shy of 8%. We won't go into detail about how to calculate that here, but it looks like this, so pause if you're curious. So if you had to bet on whether it would be exactly 50 heads or any other number, you should bet on the latter. The chance of landing on heads exactly 49 times is slightly less, equal to the chance of landing on it 51 times. And so on. Overall, if you chart the likelihood that it'll land on any exact number of heads, it'll look like this. So that's if I'm right, but what if you're right and the coin is not fair? Even a weighted coin wouldn't land on heads all the time, and a coin that lands on heads 3/4 of the time is still not fair. So how do you decide? If landing on exactly 50 isn't especially likely, but having an unfair coin doesn't mean it will be exactly 100 times either. Where do you draw the line? Well, you can look for the same 0.05 threshold on this chart. We calculated that the likelihood of landing on exactly 50 heads is about 8%, which means there's a 46% chance of being below it, and a 46% chance of being above it, or a 54% chance of being at exactly 50 or below. We also calculated the probability of landing on exactly 51 heads. Still around 8%, but a little less than landing on exactly 50. So that means the probability of landing on exactly 51 or fewer heads is about 62%. You can keep applying that same reasoning in addition until you reach that 95% threshold. And it turns out you cross that threshold at tossing 59 heads. There is a 95.6% chance of tossing 58 or fewer heads, and only a 4.4% chance of tossing 59 or more. This example also illustrates one subtlety of the definition of a p-value. Whereas the probability of landing on exactly 59 heads is smaller, there's still a 2.8% chance it could be higher than 59 heads. So you have a 4.4% chance of seeing a result at least as extreme as 59, if the data was actually from a fair coin. Throw 59 or more heads, and you have evidence to reject the null hypothesis that the coin is fair, with a p-value below the typical significance threshold of p equals 0.05. So what about p-hacking then? In the case of this coin, it's still a bit unlike studies usually done with humans. Humans are usually capable of emitting more than two responses, for example. But a broad definition of p-hacking might be looking through your data for significant results and then only reporting those. So in this case of testing whether a coin is weighted fairly, you might be able to look through all 100 tosses to see if there's a point at which five heads appear in a row. If you only toss the coin those five times, there's less than a 5% chance of getting five heads in a row, like we calculated earlier. But you didn't toss it just five times. You tossed it 100 times. And out of those 100 tosses, there are only 49 heads, about as fair as you can expect. So in this case, p-hacking could be reporting only those five tosses and pretending you didn't toss the coin 95 more times, hoping no one notices. But once you leave the subject of coin tossing and move on to humans, studies can become a bit more complex. For example, we generally understand the outcome of a coin toss to be the result of random chance, but we all know it is a deterministic process. Things like the angle of the thumb, the force, the wind speed, and whether the coin started heads or tails side up actually determine the outcome. So if we take two coins, one that we know is fair and one that we're not so sure about, and toss each of them 100 times, we'd expect an insignificant p-value if they were actually both fair coins. We don't have any evidence to reject the null hypothesis that the two coins behave in the same way. But if we took those same results and reorganized them, grouping by which face was pointing up before the toss instead of by which coin was used, we'd get a different p-value and maybe even a significant one, which is to say that the p-value depends on which variables you measure and test. It's the chance of seeing results at least that extreme if the variables you're testing don't matter. The null hypothesis presumes that what's actually explaining the outcomes is entropy and chaos, but in that chaos there are other variables you could potentially measure. This last example with an experimental group and a control looks a little more like what you'd expect if you test humans. Instead of testing the fairness of a coin, you might be testing whether there's a relationship between washing your hands and behaving ethically. Is the outcome related to whether you wash your hands or not? Or did the measured ethical behavior seem to have no relationship to hand washing, meaning unmeasured factors must have determined the behavior? As a result, p-hacking can become more subtle and can even be done unintentionally. We all have unconscious biases that could lead us to notice those five heads in a row patterns more readily. But as we cover these biases and practices in the future, it'll be good to keep this basic definition of a p-value in mind. And speaking of random chance, let's see what you all had to say about its role in determining our success. Seth brought up the fact that it's easier to measure whether or not a person had a mentor, and a little harder to measure the emotional tenor of their relationship with a mentor, and that you might be able to get some more predictive power if you assessed that as well. This is something that is in theory measurable, but it is probably less likely to be included in these analyses that have been predicting success in the past. A few people mentioned the possibility of confirmation bias in looking in this data, which is definitely an important thing to watch out for. I would venture a guess that confirmation bias is more likely when people have pre-existing beliefs that relationships exist rather than relationships don't exist and outcomes are based in random chance. However, it is still important to watch out for this, and we should pay just as much attention to data showing that relationships are there. Kim points out the example that Malcolm Gladwell talks about regarding Bill Gates and his success. He's been more open about the role he sees luck playing in determining his success, which is a bit of a counterexample to that famous quote that luck is not something that you can mention in the presence of self-made men. Priscilla tied this video to the idea of free will. You could make the case that what statisticians see as randomness is actually the result of people's freely chosen behaviors. I think if you're inclined to make that argument, you could explain a lot of the data in this way, but I'd still like to think that people's chosen behaviors could then be observed and measured, and that those behaviors could be used to predict whether or not someone will be successful. And of course, maybe free will as a whole will be a topic for another day. And a couple people reacted that this is simultaneously a troubling and comforting topic to bring up. Yeah, it is. So if you like this video and you want to participate in conversations like this, subscribe to this channel. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.